This is Sterling School. It's home to two different programs. The school itself is 747 students, divided into two groups. We have the Sterling Elementary program, which runs four-year-old kindergarten all the way to fifth grade, serves 309 students. Those students come to us in two different ways. There's a area around the school, relatively small area, that has first choice to come to us. And then the rest of the available slots are offered in the school district's choice program to the rest of the district. So about 45% of our population comes from the neighborhood around us. The rest of it comes from the community at large. The other program running here is the Charlestown Center, which is right around 420 students. Those students are third grade through eighth grade. They're selected and invited to come through a district's process where we identify the highly gifted students. We take the gifted population and then take the top 75 students through a variety of criteria to come. So everybody that comes here by choice. We function as one school, one mission, one vision, one principal, one PTA, one school improvement council on purpose. But the programs are pretty diverse. The Sterling Elementary programs, roughly 65% African American, roughly 65-70% free and reduced lunch. The Charlestown Center's 92% Caucasian and probably one of the more affluent groups of kids in the state of South Carolina. Very, very different populations. But the Charlestown Center is also, that 8% is divided much more broadly than the Sterling program. Asian, East Indian, African American, a wide range of folks. And they also come from all over the county. First of all, I hired people that share a common piece. And I'll take a little bit of a step back. The hardest part here has always been defining ourselves, because every single person that asks us this question says, what do you do? Who do you serve? And now we start talking about our why, which is we only exist to do what other people don't do well, which is in the highly gifted population, it's a group of people that typically have a high risk of high school dropout, to be honest. They have, if they're not addressed, they tend to underperform. So the district said, let's do that there. And then the other place is take a diverse school and really to close that achievement gap and really perform on a high level is the challenge in public education. You have to come here and be willing to go, if this was easy to do, everybody would do it. There are three grades that overlap. So our third grade teachers, fourth grade, and fifth grade overlap. So we have five classes in those grade levels. Two are Sterling, three are Charlestown Center. And when those grade levels started overlapping, that was that first time that we went, okay, these guys are actually going to interact. And what we found out was by the time we started thinking about that, the kids had already, they had already made friends. The kids that were second graders that qualified under the Charlestown Center had friends in the Sterling program, and we had to do very little. So when they go to lunch, they sit where they want to sit. So people sit where they want to. And the teachers work together and they collaborate. And in fourth grade, that's gotten better. And in fifth grade, it's almost seamless. We rarely talk about the differences between programs, but they're also independent. Sterling can go do something, go, hey, we're going to try this, come and see this, this is great, because they're not trying to imitate each other. And it's been very natural. There's been some things that we've done, like fourth grade this year did some things for lunch, where we let these guys sit where they wanted to, but we noticed all the kids that love Lego were sitting together, and this group of girls always sits together, and it wasn't just race, it was built by interest, and sometimes those interests sort of made everybody sit where they did. So they mix up the tables, they'll do some new friends. All of the grade levels are building in some time where we actually intermix the programs, where we had a Renaissance day and they studied Michelangelo and they painted the bottom of their desks like the Sistine Chapel, and the kids could go where they wanted to go regardless of program because it was based on interest. We're one place. They need to be natural, authentic, mutually beneficial relationships. So the band kids will go into 4K and say, you're doing a unit on sound. Let me show you how French horn works. Now the eighth grader gets his self-esteem piece because they're egocentric, and the four-year-old gets a chance to touch something they've maybe never seen before, and it works out for both people. So everybody walks away going, I got. Oh, but it just keeps getting better and better. Fortunately, we had enough lead time. I had a couple of years as principal and had the opportunity through a number of connections. you know, I was fortunate to apply for DLA and get into that. So that was life-changing. I had an opportunity to get connected with the community and really learn about Nicholltown and where we were going to be home. So we had almost a year to sort of start thinking about that. I would go to the neighborhood association meetings, but they weren't getting young families in. So I went to the Nicholltown Community Center and went to their after-school program, and I said, I'm just going to meet parents as they pick up their kids. And met a number of our students who I'm very close to, because they were the first kids I met from the community. And I think by doing that and then going to the Neighborhood Association meeting, which is very strong, teachers have joined the Neighborhood Association, we've joined as a school, and we go every month. We're not just coming to tell you about school and then we leave. I want to hear what's going on, and that has helped us make some connections that, again, make that relationship authentic. We focus on health and wellness, and we have the Swamp Rabbit Trail coming up here, and we have a community garden because they have a community garden, and we're both working on the same thing, so it's real. Somebody said, oh, it's so visionary that you have this great food program here and this healthy menu, and I said, we couldn't turn that opportunity away. It's part of what we do. And so the school has to be a point, because that's really why the school's here. The community keeps asking, what can we do to do that? You know, what can we do to support you? We gave advice last night on kindergarten, and that's the first time we've gotten up and did a little preaching, and here's what you need to do and some advice. I think you need to go out in the community and find out what's really there. I had some blind spots. I grew up in Greenville. Never drove through Nicholltown other than to see some Christmas lights when I was a little kid, and frankly drove by here a million times, but I thought I knew what it was, and I was wrong. It's a much richer, diverse community, and frankly, they value education more than anybody I know. When they go through their table at Black History Month and talk about what you do as a career, and the retired people say they're a teacher, there's a hush in the room. PTA has been fantastic. I mean, they at the beginning built in safeguards to make sure that the primary elementary program was represented, and the elementary program was represented, and the middle school was represented, and the two programs were represented. When we get money or raise funds, we look at it by need. When Dr. Fisher created this school, she sort of gave this big, you know, put them on the moon sort of thing. I want kids from the neighborhood qualifying into the Charlestown Center. I want to see this, you know, that sort of dynamic. She'd been a principal of a school in Montgomery County, Maryland, that had sort of done this, and that's great, because everybody goes, yay, I believe that, in interviews. Everybody says they believe it. You may believe it, but very few people can do it. And so as we've gone through this program, these teachers have bought in, and I know they have a lot of fear and doubt. And last year we had a couple of sort of key moments, which was one, we had a student who was from, not from Nicholltown, but from a community that's never been represented in the Charlestown Center, around the Judson community. We had a family that came here, brought their daughter here because they thought she was bright. We had just opened, we had no track record, just sort of that hope of the promise of what we would do. She qualified into the Charlestown Center. So what was cool about that is, that's not going to be in our strategic plan, and we're not putting that on the sign, but what it showed is it's possible. And if you can do it for one, then let's do it for two. And if you can do it for two, then you can do it for three. And the other thing that happened was last year, our third grade Sterling kids, when they took pass, we've had these guys for a couple of years, they took pass, and they did really well in reading and got pummeled in math, dead last in the district. And if you look at our test scores on this school, State Department website, they look great because they're intermingled with the Charlestown Center. But when we disaggregated the scores, we got hammered. And we had this moment where we said, they were really strong and said, let's go. Let's claim it. Let's own it. Let's fix it. So we went and presented that to the neighborhood, said, we're dead last. You shouldn't expect this. You should see improvement. We had 47% of our kids below basic, and that's across the program as a whole. That's not even counting just the African-American category. I was hoping for maybe a 5-10% improvement, something that I could go back to the community and say, we're fixing it. We went from 47% below basic to 7. And with that, not only was that across the Sterling program, but the exemplary category jumped up. Now, but what was also great is the African-American subcategory. If I would have taken just our African-American subcategory in math and ranked it as if it was a fourth grade class in or a fourth grade school in South Carolina, out of 700 schools, it would have been 55th. So what was great about that is those fourth grade teachers were under pressure all year, and it showed them that they can hit elite. That's elite numbers. We don't talk about test scores other than to say you rang the bell. Now let's ring it in English language arts. Let's ring it in social studies and science. And then the other thing is really great things is that we have a high quality staff. I mean, we've had 3 straight years of top 10 teachers of our teachers of the year in the top 10 for the last 3 years. We have a phenomenal staff I'm really proud of. So that connection to the community and those accomplishments show people we've got a high quality staff and we're making high quality gains. And now we're supposed to, our next piece is to export that. So, but if you can do this and then show that as a possibility for other people and inspire other folks and frankly inspire other communities to say, it is possible. It's the unintended consequences of having the Charlestown Center here, because those guys have families all across the community. So they go back to their schools and go, our cafeteria doesn't have to sit quietly all the time. Our cafeteria is like a jet airplane taking off. Well, it's loud because it's not for adults, it's for kids. And if you have kids that have a limited language exposure from 0 to 7, and then you sit there and put them in schools and say you can't talk for 25 minutes while you eat, and you must sit in a desk and rows and chairs and boy, girl, you're taking 30 minutes a day and taking it off the table as a place to make some gains. So it's crazy loud. And so now I've got parents going, how do I get my school to do this? And you're seeing it in other places. Wittenberg is another model in Greenville that's sort of gone into an underrepresented community, and you've put this super high-end school in the middle of this, and we're going to connect with the community. I mean, it's sort of this targeted piece. But I would say we started from a place of being the most elite academic. Most schools take a failing school, and you go, let's infuse something in this to fix it. I haven't done that. What I did is we took this very elite, high-end group of kids and expanded that and then put this other program with it. So there's this culture of achievement that I don't have to talk about past scores. I don't have to sit there and chase those metrics. We actually talk about instruction, and not to say there aren't still conflicts in us. I think there's always some tension between the two programs. We try to build that by 8th grade teachers sitting in faculty meetings with 5-year-old kindergarten teachers. What their needs are still different, but I've been very fortunate and I've had some key players that have come in and been super professional and said, we believe in the overall mission. Parents in the community are, and we're fortunate in that my parent base in the Charlestown Center, you know, are great role models. I mean, very well connected and have provided a lot of opportunity. And I've hired folks that had other assets as well. I mean, our connection with Furman has been phenomenal, having Furman students come in and mentor. We're more than just trying to educate kids here. We have to be a viable part of that community. And the community leaders have been key, but there's also been some really great, thoughtful people. But our PTA has been visionary. Our School Improvement Council has been very driven. And it hasn't just been about holding hands and singing Kumbaya. I mean, we've had we wrestle with a lot of issues, and I think we're really getting to the point now that comes from a very informed, progressive viewpoint that ultimately will make us a very high-achieving school that impacts the community. The district PTA does a reflections contest, which is an arts, music, literature, sort of the artistic contest. And this year the theme was diversity is, but I thought it was great. And so Carol Beard, our PTA reflections person, put all this together. And so kids submitted photographs and artwork and poetry and made videos. And it's been the most talked about art thing we've done in a while. And we have a phenomenal arts program. But it's been interesting to see the adults look at that and see how the kids have interpreted it. In this school, the race piece actually isn't nearly as big as I thought it would be. In many cases, our issues have been program piece, like how do you meet the needs of an 8th grade kid versus 6th grade kid? They're different. And a 4K kid's different than a 3rd grade kid. It was interesting when it went up because I had so many people. It was interesting just to see custodians and teachers talking about that and parents. So I was like, please leave it up.